Good morning. Welcome to Monrovia this morning. We're so thankful that you're here. Please come in and find a spot. We hope that you have enjoyed your time with family and friends for Christmas. And we're thankful that you're back here with us this morning as we come together again to worship together. We're going to start with some singing, so we encourage everyone to sing out. Let's all stand together and let's sing. Walking in sunlight all of my journey, over the mountains, through the deep vale, Jesus has said, I'll never forsake thee. Promise divine that never can fail. Heavenly sunlight, flooding my soul with glory divine. Hallelujah, I am rejoicing, singing His praises, Jesus is mine. Shadows around me, shadows above me, never conceal my Savior and guide. He is the light, in Him is no darkness. Ever I'm walking close to His side. Heavenly sunlight, flooding my soul with glory divine. Hallelujah, I am rejoicing, singing His praises, Jesus is mine. In the bright sunlight, ever rejoicing, pressing my way to mansions above. Singing His praises, gladly I'm walking, walking in sunlight, sunlight of love. Heavenly sunlight, flooding my soul with glory divine. Hallelujah, I am rejoicing, singing His praises, Jesus is mine. Lord, let Your light, light of Your face, shine on us. Lord, let Your light, light of Your face, shine on us, that we may be saved, that we to find our way in the darkest night. Let Your light shine on us. Lord, let Your grace, grace from Your hand, fall on us. Lord, let Your grace, grace from Your hand fall call on us, that we may be saved, that we may have life, to find our way in the darkest night. Let your grace fall on us. Oh Lord, let your love, love with no end, come over us. Lord, let your love, love with no end, come over us, that we may be saved, that we may have life, to find our way in the darkest night. Let your love come over us. Let your grace fall on us. Let your light shine on us. Be seated, please.
If you'll bow with me, please. Father, we'll ask you to bless this group this morning, and so many that are trying to raise their children as you would have them to do so. So many that are taking care of elderly parents, being caretakers, just so many different roles in life. We pray that you'll help this church to reach out to widows and orphans and have the courage to reach out, do things differently so as to reach the community and those around us, and try to not only help them with their physical needs, but also their help them to find you in a relationship with you and with your Son, Jesus Christ. Just thankful for all the blessings. We're so richly blessed that we take for granted. Help us to be thankful and share with others. In Jesus' name, amen.
Man of sorrows, what a name for the Son of God who came, ruined sinners to reclaim. Hallelujah, what a Savior, bearing shame and scoffing rude. In my place condemned he stood, sealed my pardon with his blood. Hallelujah, what a Savior. Guilty, vile, and helpless we, spotless Lamb of God was he. Full atonement, can it be? Hallelujah, what a Savior. Lifted up was he to die. It is finished, was his cry. Now in heaven exalted high. Hallelujah, what a Savior. When he comes, our glorious King, all his ransomed home to bring, then anew this song we'll sing. Hallelujah, what a Savior. Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescued the souls of men. Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts have hopelessly lost our way. Oh, we've hopelessly lost our way. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. Almighty, infinite Father, faithful and loving your own. Here in our weakness you find us, falling before your throne. Oh, we're falling before your throne. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for.
I was thinking last night that Jesus had said, "Come, little children, come unto me." As we approach this feast and this Lord's Supper, we should come to God and come to Christ as little children with our hearts clean and pure, thankful that he has redeemed us in the way he has so that forever our sins will not be counted to us. Shall we pray? Our Father in heaven, we bow our heads in shame that we are sinners, but we lift our hearts and our souls to you, thanking you that you did redeem us by sending your Son to die on the cross for our sins that we could not redeem ourselves from. Father, as we partake of this bread, help us, Father, to remember that great sacrifice, that sacrifice that no one living could make except your Son. And in his name we pray. Amen. Our dear Father, as we continue this prayer, we think about the blood that Jesus shed on the cross, the life-giving blood. And we know that that life that Jesus gave lives through us, through his Spirit. Pray, Father, that we continually celebrate his life and all the things that we do, that we give praise to you and praise to him. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. The elders have set aside this time for the members to have an opportunity to give to the church here so that it may do benevolent work and spread the gospel and do good things, so praise God. But any time's a good time to give. In fact, my contribution comes out on Wednesday for some reason. I don't know why, but it does. So let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for everything you've given us. We know that everything we have is because you have blessed us and blessed us highly above a lot of people in this whole world. We pray, Father, that we use this opportunity that we have to give back to those who don't have the blessings that we have, that they may be enriched, they may see your glory in everything that is done. Bless us, Father, always. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Hey, good morning, everyone. I want to thank you again for being with us today. Hope you've had a good Christmas. Just a few announcements. First, for the youth, just a note kind of for everybody. We are at capacity on Winterfest, so if you had a friend or know someone you think may have wanted to sign up or come, we just can't take any more people. We got all the seats are full, and get that stuff in early next year, right? That's a good problem to have, though. So we're happy that we have so many that were interested in coming this year. And also, just a reminder that we won't have classes or lunch today. And we also will not have classes this Wednesday. because it's New Year's Day. So just hope that you'll enjoy time with your family. And we should start back in our regular class schedule in the coming week. So at that note, we'll take about 10 minutes to greet everyone, and then we'll have our lesson. Thanks.
Okay, it's time to start back. Thank you for spending the time in the greeting this morning. It's also time for kids' church. So those kids that haven't already gone back, or adults that are helping out, it's time for you to go to the back for kids' church. All right. As you can see, Ray is here this morning. But I don't think he was planning to be here, or maybe he wasn't sure whether he was going to be here or not, might have to leave early. So he has asked Mike Weimer to speak this morning, so don't think there's anything wrong with Ray or we're trying to replace him or anything.
I just wanted to see what it's like to be a member. Indeed.
So most of you know Mike and Jeanette Weimer. Mike was here with us for several years as a member, worked at Madison Academy. He's been in Texas for a couple of years now. But they're back visiting over Christmas, and so Ray's asked Mike to speak to us this morning. We always enjoy when Mike preaches. He does a great job, so we're looking forward to that. So in preparation for his lesson, let's stand together and sing a couple of songs.
Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles. Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles. Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles. Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. God moves in a mysterious way. His wonders is to perform. He plants his footsteps in the sea and rides upon the storm. Judge not the Lord by feeble sense, but trust him for his grace. Behind a frowning providence, he hides a smiling face. Blind unbelief is sure to err and scan his work in vain. God is his own interpreter, and he will make it plain.
Be seated, please.
Thank you. Well, good morning. It really is a delight to be here with you. It's also a little bit awkward. Have you ever just, out of politeness, you know, you just say something, you kind of offer something, just being polite, and then somebody takes you up on it? I told Ray, I'm going to be in town for a few weeks. You know, if you'd like to take a Sunday off, just let me know. And he took me up on it, as if I really meant it, you know. Well, awkward. No, I'm just kidding, of course. It's a delight and a privilege to share some thoughts with you this morning. And the biggest regret that I have is that I don't get to hear Ray. I really do. I respect Ray a great deal. And I appreciate his sermons because they have an authenticity and a practicality that comes from the fact that he's not cloistered in a minister's study all week, but he's out in life and living it, and that comes through in your messages. Thank you, Ray. Do you ever just have kind of off-the-wall wonderings? You know, I wonder, you know, when I was a kid, when I did that, you know, it would usually end up with me getting in trouble or getting hurt. And as an adult, my wonderings now are more metaphysical, so they're less hazardous to my health. But I still have, you know, I wonder about things. Lately, I've really been wondering a lot about God. Perhaps it's because I have a sense that I'm going to be meeting him face-to-face sooner rather than later at this point in my life. But I've been wondering about God. Specifically, you know, what is it like for God to be God? And then the thought that's really been bouncing around my head for the last couple of months is, I wonder if God enjoys being God. Have you ever thought about, does God enjoy being God? You know, like, for example, with Jeanette and me, with our girls, you know, there were times we'd look at each other and we'd say, you know, what were we thinking? You know, but now at this point in my life, I enjoy my girls. Oh, they can still be frustrating, of course, but I really enjoy my girls. I enjoy interacting with them. I enjoy doing things for them, and it's fun being their dad. I wonder if God ever looks at us that way, and he thinks, "Hey, this is kind of fun. It's kind of fun being God." I remember reading a parenting book several years ago that talked about, you know, as a parent, you know, look for ways to make being a parent fun, and it told a story about one guy who had a son who refused to get up in the morning, and every morning it was shouting and yelling in anger and that sort of thing. He decided one day, I'm done with this, and so he went to the store, bought a big bag of marbles, put them in a large bowl, put the bowl in the freezer, and he told his son, tomorrow morning we're not going to fight. You're going to get up the first time I ask, or you'll be sorry. And when the son didn't get up, he went in, pulled the covers back, dumped the frozen marbles into his bed, and he, as he walked out, he thought, well, now that was fun, you know. At MA, a few times we'd have a parent who was having problems with their child, or we were having problems with their child. And so the parent would come and shadow their child all day, go to classes with them. And invariably, the parent at the end of the day would come up and say, "That was fun embarrassing them all day long." You know, I wonder if God ever has that kind of reflection about us. You know, like, that was fun. You know, for example, with Moses. Take Moses for instance. Okay, here the Hebrews are in Egypt, and they're just proliferating like everything. They're taking over the country, and so they pass this law that they're going to kill all the baby boys. Okay, and there's this Hebrew couple. They've been hiding their baby boy. They just can't hide him any longer. Put him in a basket and set him adrift on the Nile. And it just so happens, probably just coincidence, Pharaoh's daughter came along, saw the basket, saw the baby. Oh, what a cute kid. She takes him home to raise. And so here it is. Here it is. The one boy that Pharaoh should have killed, okay, for his plan, that one boy, Pharaoh himself ends up feeding, educating, raising that child in his very own palace. I'm sorry, folks. That's just funny to me. You know, you can just see it. Pharaoh comes home from a day at the office, and his daughter says, "Well, how's your day, Dad?" And he says, "Oh, tough day. Just killing all those Hebrew baby boys. It's just a horrible day. Oh, enough of that. Where's my grandson, Moses?" You know, the one child he should have gotten rid of. I'm sorry. There's humor there that God has Pharaoh raise the very one that he should have killed. You know, that when you think about it, that's enough to even make Nikki smile, you know. And don't get me started with Balaam and the donkey. You know, that's just a funny story. And there's some heart-touching stories. How can you read the story of Joseph forgivingly telling his brothers, "What you meant for evil, God meant for good"? God's hand was in that all along. And the specialness of that story. There's a couple other stories I want to go into. And this was actually, when I was reading this in 2 Kings a couple of months ago, this is actually what prompted my whole wanderings about all of this. What's going on here in 2 Kings is Elisha has been befriended by a wealthy couple. The husband's older, and they don't have any children, but they befriend Elisha. And so as a thank you to them for their kindnesses, he asks God to bless them with a son. And so they have a son. And then later on, as a young man, he's out in the field helping his dad. He complains of a headache, and he dies. The wife then summons Elisha. Elisha comes, and he brings and raises the child from the dead. Later on then, she's widowed by this time, and a famine is coming into the land. And so Elisha goes to her and said, "There's going to be a famine here for 7 years. You'd be better off living elsewhere during the time of this famine." So she leaves, and then in 2 Kings 8, rather, she's on her way back. She's on her way back to get her land back. And so she's going to go to the king and say, "I've been gone during the famine. I'd really like to have my land back. Is there anything you could do to help me?" And here's the story. Okay. And as she came in, the king was talking to Gehazi. Gehazi is Elisha's servant, the servant of the man of God. The king said, "Tell me some stories about the great things Elisha has done." And Gehazi was telling the king about the time that Elisha had brought a boy back to life. At that very moment, the mother of the boy walked in to make her appeal to the king about her house and land. "Look, my lord," the king, Gehazi exclaimed, "here is the woman now, and this is her son, the very one Elijah brought back to life." "Is this true?" the king asked her. And she told him the story. So he directed one of his officials to see that everything she had lost was restored to her, including the value of the crops that had been harvested during her absence. Isn't that a neat story? Here this widow is, and she's had some resources, but she's still a widow. She comes back and wants her land back, and God sets this all up where Gehazi and the king are talking and visiting together. And the king says, "Well, tell me some things about it." And so he starts telling him this story. And right at that very moment, the woman comes in. Wow, what a coincidence. Isn't that a neat story? And of course, another one of perhaps my favorite Old Testament story, and Linda Good knows this, the story of Mordecai and Esther. Okay, now it's about 500 years before Christ. Mordecai and Esther are living in the mighty Median Persian Empire, and Esther is a Jewish orphan girl being raised by her cousin Mordecai. The king, a fellow by the name of Xerxes, has just gone over to Greece and in a war and has gotten beaten badly. He comes back home. He's dejected, and there's a lot more to the story, but he ends up just spending all his time with his harem and wants a new queen. Esther is a lovely young lady, and so she's invited to be part of Xerxes' harem and in the running to be the new queen. And when she goes off to Susa, the capital city, for some reason, Mordecai tells her, he doesn't tell her why, he just says, "Don't tell anyone that you're Jewish." Okay, I won't tell anyone. And so then he moves to Susa also. And so every day then, Mordecai, after work, goes out and hangs out at the palace gate just to check up on Esther, make sure she's doing okay. And lo and behold, she's selected to be the new queen. Over the whole Persian Empire, 127 provinces from India to Ethiopia, and she's the new queen. And so Mordecai keeps checking up on her, and it just so happens, probably coincidence, one day when he's hanging out at the palace gates, he overhears two of the king's eunuchs complain about the king, and they get involved in a plot to assassinate the king. Mordecai listens in on it, so that's my cousin's husband they're talking about. So he tells Esther. Esther tells the king. It's investigated, and sure enough, the story is found to be true, and those two servants were executed. And it was recorded in the daily record of how this plot was uncovered by a fellow by the name of Mordecai, and the king's life was saved. Well, in the meantime, as I told you, the king really didn't spend much time running the government. And so a new prime minister came up. His name was Haman, and he really ran the government for everyone. And Haman was all about Haman. He was an egotist of the first degree. One of the first laws he made was that when he came in and out of the palace area, everybody around the gate would have to bow down to him. And of course, who is it that hangs around the gates all the time? Mordecai. Mordecai refuses to bow to Haman. It makes Haman furious. And so Haman and his friends come up with a plot to get rid of all the Jews. And so they come up with this plan to get rid of all the Jews. And that's when Mordecai goes to Esther. He says, "Who knows? Maybe you have come to the kingdom for such a time as this." Well, just getting rid of the Jews is not enough for Haman. He's so furious with Mordecai, he decides he wants to execute Mordecai. He builds a gallows 75 feet high. I'm going to show everybody, you better show me respect. And so he and his friends get together this plan to execute Mordecai. One authority he does not have, though, is that's the power of capital punishment. And so so he has to get the king's permission. So it's by the time he gets this plan together to kill Mordecai in the morning, it's late into the evening. But he goes to the palace to ask the king permission to have Mordecai put up on this gallows in the morning. Well, as all that's going on, that night, it was probably just coincidence, the king couldn't get to sleep. And so he asked one of his servants, why don't you go grab one of the old newspapers and just read an old newspaper to me, and maybe that will help me to fall asleep. And so the servant goes and he pulls out an old newspaper. He just so happens, probably coincidence, but he just so happens to get the old newspaper that tells the story about how two eunuchs were plotting to assassinate the king, and his life was saved by an informant by the name of Mordecai. He says, did we ever do anything to reward him for saving my life? And the servant said, well, there's nothing written here. He said, well, we need to do something to honor him. Are any of my servants in the palace area where they could come and give me some advice on this? And the servant looks out, he said, well, Haman just walked in. And so, tell him to come on in here. So Haman comes on in. And of course, Haman, you know, hey, King, I've got this request. Oh, just a minute. You can ask me in just a minute. I need your advice, Haman. Yeah, of course, you need my advice because I'm so important. And the king says, what should the king do for the man in whom he delights to honor? And of course, Haman thinks he's talking about me. And he says, well, what I'd like you to do for me, I mean for this person, is put them on your royal horse with your royal robe and have somebody really important in the kingdom lead them around the capital city of Susa, shouting out praises to their name. He said, that's a great idea, Haman. First light, I want you to do that. What was that guy's name? Oh, this fellow by the name of Mordecai. I want you to find him and I want you to do that for him. Now, Haman, what was it you came here for? Okay. And as the story progresses, Mordecai replaces Haman. There's a lot of neat things with that. He reports, and the Jewish people are saved. In the story of Esther, in the 10 chapters of Esther, God's name doesn't appear once, but his fingerprints are all over that story. The providence of God putting a Jewish orphan girl in a position of influence that saves the life of the Jewish people. And it's not just Bible stories. You know, Voltaire, the French atheist philosopher, said, 100 years from my death, the Bible will be a museum piece. Okay, 58 years after Voltaire's death, a fellow in Geneva becomes the new president, new executive of the Evangelical Society of Geneva, and he happens to own the house that Voltaire used to live in. And just 58 years later, it's documented that he stored Bibles and religious tracts at his house as part of his role with the Evangelical Society. That's just funny. You know, here Voltaire is, you know, the Bible's, and then his own house 58 years later is being used to store Bibles and tracts. You know, I just don't think that's a coincidence. I think God was just having some fun with that. I believe in the providence of God. I believe that God is active in the lives of his people. And of course, we love these stories of power and deliverance, of Esther, and of care for a widow, and an arrogant philosopher being shown up. We love those kinds of stories, but what do we do with John the Baptist in a dungeon in Macarius, and he sends his disciples to Jesus and say, are you really the Messiah? And then to satisfy the vengeance of an adulteress, his head is severed. Or how do we explain John the Apostle living to such an old age, but his own brother James was the first apostle to be martyred, shoved off a wall of the temple, and then had his head beat in with a club? How do we reconcile those things? You know, I don't have an answer for why a tornado devastates one family and then seemingly miraculously turns and spares another family. And they say, oh, God spared us. Well, what about the family that got wiped out? You know, how do we deal with that? How do we know when it's just the natural laws that God set up in nature and it just happens? You know, in Luke 13, the Tower of Siloam fell. And it just happened, and the guys underneath it, you know, and there were fellas killed. You know, how do we balance God's omnipotence with the heartbreaking times of his silence? How do we balance God's omnipresence with the free will of evil people? I wonder, why do some people experience such heartache and tragedy in their lives, and I've been so blessed and free of tragedy? Just before we got up here, the last song, Mickey led us in God Moves in a Mysterious Way, written by William Cooper. And I know it's spelled Cowper, but it's pronounced Cooper. I was there at the time, so I know. William struggled with insanity most of his adult life. He heard voices. On two different occasions, he tried to commit suicide because he thought God was telling him to kill himself. But what turned William Cooper's life around, where he could write a poem like God Moves in a Mysterious Way — he's got a lot of other poetry out there, secular poetry — but just so happened a fellow by the name of John Newton, former slave ship captain and turned preacher and author of Amazing Grace, just happened to move in behind him, and they were backyard neighbors and shared a hedge. And the two of them became good friends. And it was during that time of that friendship that sanity returned to William Cooper, and he was able to produce this hymn that we sing. And William Cooper saw this time, this relationship with the former slave ship captain, he saw that as evidence of God's providence, of God's care for him and meeting his needs in a very, very special way. And I like this. The last verse that I have up on the slide is actually the fourth verse of the much longer poem. Judge not the Lord by feeble sense, but trust him for his grace. Behind a frowning providence, he hides a shining smiling face. Was it just coincidence? William Cooper didn't think so. He believed that it was God working in his life. I believe in the providence of God. And when confronted with these issues, where I retreat to is to realize that God is so great and I'm so small and insignificant. I'm not going to understand God. And maybe that's the whole point. Maybe it's the point, and this is a point that Jenny shared with me just this week. Maybe it's the point, oh, look what God did for me. No, it's about God. I like this passage from Isaiah. My thoughts are nothing like your thoughts, says the Lord, and my ways are far beyond anything you could imagine. For just as the heavens are higher than the earth, so my ways are higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts. Isn't that amazing? Okay, maybe that's what it's all about. 1 Corinthians 13, we think of the love chapter, but Paul says, now we see things imperfectly as in a cloudy mirror, but then we will see everything with perfect clarity. Maybe the whole point is that we really just are now getting a glimpse of all the things that God's involved in our lives. And it's not until 2020 hindsight that we'll really be able to recognize all the providence of God and all the things that God has done for us. There's a fellow by the name of Keith Miller that several years ago wrote a book called The Second Touch, and he tells a really neat story. He tells a story about in the middle of the night, their young daughter was whimpering, and his wife nudged him and said, it's your turn to get her up. And so he got up, and he went over and picked her up, carried her into the bathroom, set her down on the potty, and she was more asleep than she was awake. And he said he had to prop her up to keep her from falling off the toilet. And he said he was just overwhelmed with love for her there in the middle of the night, helping her to meet her needs. And then he was struck by a very sad thought. He said, but she's asleep to me. She will never remember that I got her up in the middle of the night and I loved her and saw to it that her needs were being taken care of. And she's asleep to me. She'll never know it. And then the thought hit him, figuratively speaking, I wonder how many times God's gotten me up in the middle of the night and I'm just asleep to him. I believe that when we get to heaven, we will be absolutely amazed by all the things that God has done for us. Romans 8:28 is the passage that I retreat to when I don't understand why some things happen. And we know that in all things, God works for the good for those who love him and are called according to his purpose. Now, the old King James Version translates that all things work together for good. And no, there's a lot of bad out there. The NIV translates it a little bit different. It says, in all things. And I actually think it's a better translation, kind of construction in the original language there. But in all things, what it means is that our God is big enough to take any situation, no matter how bad that situation is, and bring good out of it. I believe that our God is that kind of a God. And so that's where I retreat to. I like old movies. Back in 1949, Cecil B. DeMille's Samson and Delilah with Victor Mature. Okay, does anybody else here remember that movie besides it? All right, good. There's a scene in that movie that's really neat. Okay, Delilah has already cut off his hair, and the Philistines have him, and they're getting ready to gouge out his eyes. And Victor Mature, Samson, looks up to heaven, and he said, you take away my sight. You take away my eyes that I might see more clearly. Isn't that a neat idea? That even in a horrible situation, circumstances that were not good at all, within that, there can be a blessing that ultimately is for our benefit. And there's other passages that I just like. Psalm 37, once I was young, now I am old, yet I have never seen the godly abandoned or their children begging for bread. That tells me that God is concerned about the daily issues of life, where we live life every day. And even when the bad things happen, 1 Corinthians 10, the temptations or trials that we're experiencing, they're common to everyone. But God will not allow you to be tempted or tried beyond what you can bear. Okay. One author has said that means our problems are father filtered. Nothing's going to happen to me. If something really tragic happens to me, then God's actually complimenting my faith. Not that I want to go through it, but he's complimenting my faith because it wouldn't have happened to me if I couldn't take it. That's what that passage promises to us. And I'm not saying that 2020 will be a year of great blessings for all of us. In fact, there may be some real problems. There may be some real tragedies in our lives in 2020. But I do have the promise that God cares and that even in the midst of those problems, God will take care of us. We live in a broken, fallen, and sinful world. Evil people, even Joseph's brothers, can victimize very innocent people. God is more concerned with our character than he is with our circumstances. God much more desires that I be holy than happy. One of my professors once made the comment, he said that not everything that happens, nothing happens without the will of God, but not everything that happens is the will of God. And so as Paul told the Thessalonians, be thankful in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you who belong in Christ Jesus. It's not that the circumstance is God's will, but that we're thankful for a God who's big enough to deal with any of those circumstances. That's what his will for us is that we be thankful people, that we recognize who he is. But let's not take this as carte blanche, because of circumstances, oh, God must think this is okay. When we lived in Southern California, we had a very dear friend who was a preacher, and he got involved in an affair with another preacher's wife. And I remember when I went and talked to him, I said, you know, what's going on? And he looked at me, he said, if God didn't want us together, why did he put us together? No, just because it's circumstantial doesn't give us the authority to do what God doesn't want us to do. There's a neat story in 1 Samuel 24. David's fleeing from Saul. He goes into a cave with his men to hide from Saul. And so they're back in the cave, and Saul comes into that very cave to relieve himself. And so David's friends say, ah, today the Lord is telling you, I will certainly put your enemy into your power to do with as you wish. They're saying, hey, God's delivered him here. Go kill him. David crept up, cut the hem off Saul's robe so he could show Saul, if I'd wanted to, I could have killed you. But even at that, it said that David felt bad because Scripture said, do not lift your hand against the Lord's anointed. David, at least in this circumstances, allowed Scripture to rule rather than circumstances. Scripture will always be our true guide. That's where we always need to go back to. Because we can deceive ourselves by allowing circumstances to let us do what we know God would never approve. A few years ago, I was living in the Dallas-Fort Worth Metroplex. I got involved in a ministry at the University of Texas at Dallas. UTD has the second largest Chinese population of any university in the country. We had a program called Friends Speak, where we offered English lessons to foreign students, and we'd use the Bible as our textbook to study English. And I got paired up with a gentleman by the name of Pan Liu. And Pan and I were together for about 10 months. He was a visiting professor from a university in Shanghai. And Pan knew nothing about Christianity. He had never met a Christian. He had never seen the name of Christ in print. And he became fascinated with Jesus. I remember one evening we were reading together, and a lot of times to help them understand the language, just not reading the words, but also reading the context for understanding and comprehension. And one night we were reading a passage out of Luke where Jesus was critical of the Pharisees, and he said, what Jesus said, wouldn't that have made them angry? And I said, oh yeah, he's going to make them so angry, they're eventually going to murder him. And his eyes got real big, and he said, they murdered him. He had never heard the whole story. After we'd been studying together for about 3 months, one evening, he looked at me and he said, Chinese government only want us to believe in socialism. And this is the way he said it. But I believe in Godeth. I believe Godeth brought me to America. I believe Godeth made us friends. Shortly after that, we started reading the book of Acts, and one night we started talking about baptism. I remember him, with great concern, looking at me. He said, but if I do that, I may lose my job, because all the professorships are government jobs. And then after we'd been together for about 10 months, less than a week before he went back to China, Pan asked me to baptize him. And I went to his apartment to pick him up, and as we were heading to the church, I noticed he picked up a large paper bag, and I didn't really think anything of it. After he was baptized, he reached in that paper bag, and it was a brand new set of clothes. Even still had the labels on them. And I kind of looked at him curious, and he said, I'm a new person, and I'm going to put on new clothes to show I'm a new person. I believe that God wants to work in our lives to make us a new person. Because of the government situation, Pan and I have not been able to stay in touch with each other. But when we have our reunion in heaven and we start comparing our notes, I think we will be absolutely amazed. We will be absolutely amazed at what God has done in our lives. And when we see how all the pieces fit together, how the puzzle fits together, and we see the extent of God's providence, I think we will absolutely be amazed. I think we'll sit back and just chuckle and say, I had no idea. Because we're not going to understand God. I took Pan to a Texas Rangers game. It went into extra innings. And Pan didn't understand a thing about baseball. He was confused by, oh, is it still going on? I thought you said it was going to be over. Okay. In the same way Pan didn't understand that baseball game, magnify that manyfold, and we are going to be absolutely amazed at what God's doing in our lives. And folks, if you don't have the assurance that God is working in your life, if you don't have the assurance that you're going to heaven to be able to see that whole plan that he has, please make steps today, right now, to address that issue as we stand and sing.
Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come, I come. Just as I am and waiting not to spot, O Lamb of God, I come, I come. I come broken to be mended, I come wounded to be healed, I come desperate to be rescued, I come empty to be filled. I come guilty to be pardoned by the blood of Christ the Lamb. And I'm welcomed with open arms, praise God, just as I am. But mercy and grace my freedom bought, and now to glory in your cross, O Lamb of God, I come. I come broken to be mended, I come wounded to be healed, I come desperate to be rescued, I come empty to be filled, I come guilty to be pardoned by the blood of Christ the Lamb. And I'm welcome with open arms, praise God, just as I am, oh, just as I am, praise God. praise God just as I am. Please be seated.
I had back surgery about 6 weeks ago, and steps are still a problem. So if I fall off, just let me leave. Thank you, Mike. I can't remember when I've heard a lesson on the providence of God that was that clear and that sharp. You've done a great job. Thank you very much. And yes, I agree with you. We're going to be totally amazed. I want to read a poem that was written by someone of this congregation, just for what I'm about to do. We're going to honor some of the people that do things here for this church that we never see. Now, Ray we see all the time. We know sort of what he does. And Mickey too. But there's some others that don't. But this was a poem that was written just for these people. Together we've been called and strive to always stay involved, to serve the awesome God above who reached out to show us his love. By sending his one and only son to pay the price for everyone, together we do what we can to share that love with our fellow man. Now, as the year finally ends, our attention is on you. As we recognize those of you who serve us all in the jobs that you do, this gift is to show that we care and given out of the love we share with the hope that you'll know it's true. We greatly appreciate each one of you. Ray, Jason, Mickey, Paula, and Brian Bates, would you guys come up here, please? You think you're going to get something. I'm keeping this for myself. There's one person who's not here, and that's Andra, who's our church secretary. I guess if you were to say, I served as a minister for 40 years, and I learned very early in my ministry that the glue that holds a church together is probably the church secretary, not the elders. And I would challenge anybody who would disagree with that. But Andra's not here, but she'll get her reward later. As I look at each one of you, I look at the things that you do. Now, Paula, nobody sees what she does. They don't see her going around here cleaning up after us. We see what Ray does. We see what Mickey does. Jason and Brian's lost back there in the booth, and we don't know what he does back there. But we're... Yeah, he's the one that makes, by the way, Brian and that crew back there is the one that makes us sound good, literally. So we have these gifts for each one of you, and I'm going to try to do this without dropping something, Ray, Jason, Mickey, Brian. Oh, okay. All right. I got two out there for Paula. We appreciate these people for the work that they do. And I would like, in our closing prayer, to give a prayer of thanks for those people. Will you bow with me, please? Father, we are a small group of believers here at Monrovia, but you have blessed us with immense talent. And these people standing behind me, Father, are proof of the way that you have gifted us with talent and spiritual gifts. Thank you for these people. Thank you for each one who's not up here who uses their gift to your glory. Bless each one of us, Father, that in the coming year we will strive to keep on doing what you have called us to do. In the name of Jesus, amen.